Doctor Who, The Macra Terror by Ian Stuart Black, read by Anneke Wills. Chapter 1. Interference on the Scanner. The Doctor had complete and utter faith in the TARDIS, accepting it almost as an extension of his own nervous system. His continued existence in time and space, and indeed the existence of his small crew, depended on its mechanics, its electronics, and on the very fabric of its structure. But in the galaxies through which his ship voyaged, there was no way of forecasting the unpredictable. External events could hit the TARDIS, and there would be a split second, a fragment of this time in which they'd travelled, before the ship's computers made adjustments. And in that split second, they were all vulnerable. That was the moment in which might be glimpsed the unexpected, the unexplained. And sometimes it was truly terrifying. The Doctor himself seemed very little put out. He'd seen the vision that had appeared on the screen of the time scanner, filling the entire vision plate, indistinct and abrupt, before it disappeared, hardly giving one a chance to record the picture, and making memory doubt itself. In fact, the Doctor continued to play a tuneless jig on his recorder. When Jamie turned to look at him, hoping for some reassurance, the Doctor appeared more interested in his music as he moved away thoughtfully to check the instruments that now began to indicate the moment of arrival. None of the others spoke, but Jamie was sure they'd all seen that something on the screen, for both Ben and Polly looked shaken. "What was that?" asked Ben. His voice wasn't much more than a whisper. The strength seemed to have gone out of him. But the Doctor heard him from across the deck, for he cheerfully called back in reply, "Atmospherics!" The others looked at him blankly. It didn't seem to be any sort of an explanation. The Doctor smiled and busied himself with the indicators. "Yes," he added. "Simple, you know. Atmospherics cause interference. A build-up of forces. Electrical discharges, a thunderstorm. A number of things can cause the normal pattern to be broken. And then a radio signal or a television picture suddenly is broken into, and you get an alien signal. We have checks and balances on board the TARDIS to counteract such interference, but every now and again, a message or picture breaks through from another point in space, and we pick it up." He went on fussing over the gears, and finally tuned the materialization. Had the Doctor not seen what they had seen? "That was horrible," said Polly. She shivered. Neither of the young men blamed her. Her fear was obvious in her eyes.
"I didn't see exactly what it was," said Jamie.
"Nor did I," Ben nodded. "It filled the screen, but I couldn't see its shape."
"It was like a huge claw," Jamie tried to recall the picture they had seen. "But not exactly real, not animal, just a great claw, with nerve ends like feelers."
"There was something about it made my skin go cold," said Ben.
"Don't talk about it," Polly whispered. "You heard what the Doctor said. It's probably something that flashed across our screen from millions of miles away. From another time, perhaps."
The others fell silent. Each in his own way wanted to believe Polly's explanation, but it was hard, and Jamie felt they'd better be ready for anything. The sound of the ship's engines took on a new quality, as though they were driving into increased pressure.
"Here we go," sang out the Doctor. "Stand by, etc., etc. Prepare to land or go ashore."
He glanced up at the scanner. The outline of a green and wooded landscape loomed up. The Doctor snapped off the controls before him. He gave an encouraging grin and waved his recorder towards the screen.
"We're there."
Vision control was automatically programmed to pinpoint items of importance according to the Doctor's pre-setting, and the screen revealed a countryside of hills, woods and streams. It reminded them very much of Earth, though it was perhaps a little more primitive.
Over the sound system, they were surprised to hear music, applause, and laughter. The picture on the screen came to a halt, resting on what looked a familiar sight to Ben. "What's that?" asked Jamie. "It's an holiday camp," said Ben. "I've been to one." "What do you do there?" asked Jamie. "Just what it says," Ben told him. "It's all fun and games. We went once when I was a kid. I thought it was a lot of fun at the time. There was a band."
"Look," Polly pointed. "There is a band."
It had just come into view on screen. The camera panned upwards from the drum majorette's well-shaped legs to the girl banging the big drum. She was standing outside an enclosed compound. The gates beside her were wide open. Beyond lay gardens, chalets, swimming pools, sports grounds, with one or two larger buildings in the background.
"It's an holiday camp, all right," said Ben with growing enthusiasm. "We've come to the right place."
Whatever the horror was which they'd seen on the TARDIS scanner, Ben had forgotten.
"Caw," he grinned, "takes me back."
The picture on the scanner changed as vision control panned from the drum majorette and her fellow musicians and focused on the crowd who were looking on with pleasure. Some had begun dancing. Watching from a short distance away were two men. Unlike the rest of the crowd, they were not dressed in holiday style, but wore a subdued dress that could have been a uniform. One was clearly of importance, a dark, powerful fellow watching everything. Ben immediately recognised him for what he was.
"They are. See them? They always have them in these camps. That will be the commandant. He has to keep the fun going or the customers will want their money back."
The doctor stood silently at their backs. When he spoke, it was as though to himself.
"I shouldn't wonder if he isn't called the pilot of this colony," he said.
"Colony?"
Ben questioned.
"Colony, camp, call it what you will," said the doctor.
Doubt had vanished from his face, and he was grinning cheerfully again.
"Okay," said Ben. "Commandant, pilot, anything you like."
"They can't be very far away," said Polly. The doctor made a calculation.
"Less than a mile."
"Let's see if we can find them,"
she suggested.
"That looks like fun."
They turned off the screen and headed for the door. Had they stayed watching for a few moments more, they might not have been quite so sure of the welcome they would get. The doctor was right. The dark, powerful man was indeed called the pilot, and by his side was a man, clearly an assistant, whom he addressed as Barney. They had an amused, almost proprietary look as they watched the band play and the crowd begin to dance. A carefree holiday air was all around. Dancers, players, officials, all were in a relaxed mood, as though they were enjoying a special occasion, a holiday after a long, hard stint of work, the doctor guessed. As the band marched to its own music and headed towards the building inside the gates, the pilot turned to the man beside him and clapped him on the shoulder.
"A first-rate band you've put together there, Barney. Nice rhythm, well rehearsed, splendid."
The other man flushed with pleasure.
"Thank you, pilot."
"I won't say you'll come out first at the festival," added the pilot cautiously. "You'll have pretty good competition, but you'll do well."
He lapsed into a number of clichés.
"Never say die. Nothing succeeds like success. If at first you don't succeed..."
They were heading back with the crowds towards a tent with a sign saying, "Refreshing Department," swinging above the door. The crowd broke into applause as the band swung past. Then suddenly, above the music and laughter, they could hear a man shouting,
"Stop him! Don't let him get out! Stop! Me doc!"
The pilot was suddenly concerned. "It's Ola's voice," said Barney.
"What's the matter with him?"
"Sounds like me doc's giving trouble," said Barney.
They couldn't see for the crowd round them.
"Me doc?"
"Yes, Ola's in charge of him." "Shut the gates, for his own sake, shut the gates," someone shouted.
"That's Ola, all right," said Barney.
He ran to the mechanism that controlled the big gates. At that moment, a man burst from the tent ahead of them and raced.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.